Welcome to Family Basics 101. I'm Dr. Bruce McClure, and as we continue our five-part series on addictions, today we will focus on how the addictions or the addicted individual's behavior impacts the entire family system. The term collateral damage is better known in the realm of wartime combat. But in families, when addictions are present, or even when those addictions are overcome, the impact on the extended family oftentimes creates scares, scars, wounds, fears, and family members' ability to really focus on the future in a comfortable, quiet manner. The family members will actually become more emotionally distressed. The same addictions or the addicted person's behaviors will also cause even the individual extended family members to almost fear for life itself. In essence, depending on the type of addiction, the family members will be so afraid of a relapse or what might happen in the life of the individual, that it will actually cause the extended family members to operate within a hypervigilance and not be able to settle down in their own family environment. So when we look at the addictions and the addicted person's behaviors on the entire family, begin to think in terms of it is much broader than the individual himself or herself. Living in a family with addictions creates abnormal stressors that impacts each family member differently. The normal, healthy expectations becomes distorted by the unexpected, the unhealthy, and sometimes even the frightening behavior of the individual who is suffering from the addiction. Family members will make every effort to make concessions, attempt to appease, even try to avoid, and even please the individual with the addiction in a simple attempt to avoid the stressful emotions and the behaviors that they know it's going to bring within the family constellation. The clinical term for the efforts of the other family members to help appease, to try and avoid, is what we call an enabler. Because at the end of the day, there are no appeasing behaviors. There are no avoiding behaviors that can really create a calm within the mind and the attitude of the addicted person. The family, in essence, becomes a walking time bomb of tension due to some family members who challenge the addicted person's behavior. Now, that seems strange, but simply because there is a family member or family members who will confront the abnormal behavior of the individual, then the family tension, rather than being calmer, will actually escalate. Some family members will even defend the addicted person's behavior. Some family members will deny that the behaviors even exist, and they will attack the individual or individuals within the family who is saying, "There is something wrong within our family." The addicted person will move throughout the entire family constellation, acting as if the addict is the victim, and yet knowing that they are creating havoc, and they have no intention to modify or to address the addiction in which they are in. According to Eric Erickson's child development theory, he looks at the child between birth and 18 months, and he says this is the age of such critical development of a child in which they develop trust, or mistrust. They develop the trust and the mistrust of their environment, of adults, and future relationships. But imagine a child growing up in an addicted home, addicted with whatever that addiction is, that abnormal behavior. The children in the home where addictions are become overwhelmed emotionally, and because they do not, nor do they have the ability to process cognitively the things that are happening in that home environment, then the child begins to see not how to trust, but in essence how to mistrust. Or if they trust, they begin to trust in a very abnormal way that extends into their adult relationships. And they begin to respond in adult relationships that are independent of the home, the way they've learned to cope in their addicted home relationships, where there were addictive behaviors very early in their childhood development, in essence between birth and 18 months. Children begin to compensate by crying, showing anxiety, not being able to settle down, being extremely withdrawn, almost being emotionless, showing hostility, moving into a fantasy world of make-believe. They may become overachievers. They may excel in sports. They may excel academically. But these are the different coping mechanisms of children when there are addictions in their home. Now, most findings will agree that the most devastating impact on family members is the unhealthy resistance to bonding with people who are healthier than the addicted individual and others within the family who enable or who become codependent to the addicted family member's behavior. Healthy people and healthy relationships are rejected in an attempt to maintain what we call the homeostasis of the addicted home. So moving from that early development stage that Eric Erickson called trust and mistrust, as that person begins to move into high school, college, young adulthood, and their personal adult relationships, the contradiction is they will reject healthy relationships because they are maintaining the homeostasis of their addicted home environment. So what is normal, that individual as an adult may define as abnormal, because now they are trying to replicate or at least find what the abnormal home addiction environment created. In the book of 1 Kings chapter 22, verses 51 through 53, there's a story about a lineage from a man named Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who was an evil man who was, he just sinned and he did everything contrary to right. But I want you to see generations later how the impact of the addictive behavior of Jeroboam continued. Ahaz, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel, or Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel in Samaria in the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah. And he reigned 2 years over Israel, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord, walked in the ways of his father, and in the ways of his mother, and in the ways of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who made Israel sin, for he served Baal, worshipped him, provoked him to anger. In essence, the generational sin, the generational addiction continued. It always impacts families unless the family is willing to break out of it. I'll see you back in class again next time. Don't be late and don't skip class.